BBC Radio Scotland on a sunny Friday morning for most of us across Scotland today, wherever you are, whatever you're doing. I hope you're having a good day. Thank you very much indeed for your company. Musician Ed Sheeran talking about being an all or nothing guy when it comes to his relationship with food. We're going to discuss men's relationship with food and why they need to be more open about it. Pop singer Ed Sheeran has sparked a conversation about eating disorders and men's relationship with food after he said he identifies closely with parts of Elton John's autobiography. Well, how common is that experience? And would more men in the spotlight, like Ed Sheeran, talking about it, help others? Joining me to talk about this, I want to introduce Dave Chawner now. Dave's a comedian, author, and a mental health campaigner as well. Dave, morning. Thanks for your time this morning.
Good morning, Stephen. How are you?
I'm good today. Yeah, I really appreciate you talking to us about this morning and about your experience specifically with an eating disorder. What happened to you?
So it was when I was about 16, 17, it developed rather than began. People kept on saying, oh, mate, I think you're anorexic. And my mom kept on crying and screaming at me. And that just seemed far too intense to describe what was going on with me. And I never identified that I might be anorexic. And it took me 4 or 5 years to really get to that point, by which time it really taken a grip. And I think the fact that Ed Sheeran actually pins it to addiction, personally for me, is really a good analogy, because it is one of those things that sometimes when you realise you've got it, it might be a little bit too embedded.
What was the moment, Dave? Can you remember a specific moment when you recognised that you had the problem?
Yeah, well, when I was at university, there were these summer schools that you could go and work as a teacher, teaching kids English as a foreign language. And we had so much fun, and it was great. It was terribly paid, but the fun was brilliant. And the reason this is all relevant is because I went down to Somerset, and I was working in this remote, tiny part of Somerset. And I remember getting there, and the food was just pizza, pasta, chips. There was no calorie count. There was no healthy option. And I started trying to avoid food. I started to try and avoid meal times. And then I started stealing food so that I could eat on my own rather in front of people. And that led to a rat infestation. And everyone found out what I was doing. It was so embarrassing. And then I started setting my alarm in the middle of the night so I could do laps of the campus and I could do my sit-ups. And it just showed me how much the fact that I had no control of my food, how much this was really getting to me. And it was just one of the teachers said, oh, by the way, I've had bulimia and I've been in therapy 3 times. Have you ever thought that you might be anorexic? And the fact that someone asked me rather than told me was a real turning point for me. And it put the control in my court. And I thought, well, yeah, maybe I am anorexic.
How did you get help?
So I was very fortunate and very lucky. Unfortunately, I continued to unthread and I went to the GP because I was displaying signs of depression. And the GP said, look, you aren't going to get rid of the depression until you get rid of the anorexia. And I knew what I was doing and I akined it to a slow suicide attempt. And I started writing the letters and preparing for stuff when the disease eventually took me. And I refused treatment 4 times. And it was only when one of the doctors got really frustrated with me and said, look, bottom line, you wouldn't expect your laptop to work if you don't charge it. You can't expect your brain to work if you don't feed it. And I realized that actually what I was doing was pushing people away. I was having massive mood swings. I couldn't concentrate. I was nowhere near myself. And I had a decision of whether to engage with treatment or not and wait for it to take its course. And I got wonderful treatment at the Maudsley Hospital down in London. And I was there for 2.5 years and diagnosed as severely clinically anorexic. And I had this amazing treatment. And I kind of want to pay that forward to blokes and other people out there to say that you don't have to be stick thin or weigh less than a bag of crisps in order to be anorexic. And anorexia is just one of many eating disorders.
How are you now?
Oh, shit. Yeah, well, now, to be honest, I'm focusing the other way. When I was discharged, I remember they weighed me and my therapist said, well, you're technically now overweight. And I remember me and her kind of laughing and go, is that success? Is that failure? And I'm not going to lie, with lockdown and exercise being restricted and food being around all the time, that's been really tough. Like, it's been tough for everyone. But I can recognize that, and the recognizing that is the first stage to not obsessing about it and being healthier in my attitude towards food, but also realizing that food was only the outlet. It was actually the stuff underneath that was really what the eating disorder was about.
Dave, thanks for being so honest.